Thank you very much, and thank you for coming to this evening lecture. One way to cure cancer, it would be to detect it early, because we know that if you're able to find a cancer in a patient when it's at an early stage, so it's very small and it didn't spread locally or to distant organs, it's going to be easier to cure. So we have there the hope to cure the patients. How can we do that? One good strategy is finding biomarkers in the blood or biofluids of the patients. So biomarkers can be molecules, in our case, proteins, because we are a proteomic group and we love proteins. These proteins are shed in the circulation by small lesions, small tumors, or infectious diseases. By detecting these traces of disease in the biofluids early, we are able to identify patients and hopefully cure that. And the statistics, they prove that. If we see if the 5-year survival rate, so how many patients are alive after 5 years since the diagnosis of cancer, in most of the cases is very high. For breast cancer is almost 100%. So almost 100% of the patients that have been diagnosed with the breast cancer that is early stage and local, they're able to survive and they're able to be cured. On the other hand, if these patients are diagnosed late, well, then the 5-year survival rate drops dramatically. So it is really compelling to be able to diagnose the cancer early. So this evening, I'm going to discuss a little bit my story and my effort in try and pursue this goal of early diagnosis through biomarker in the blood. So my story begins here. This is Palazzo della Ragione in Padova, and it's a beautiful town hall that was built in the 1200s. And it has a very big hall with beautiful frescoes, and it's thought to be the biggest room in Europe that is not supported by columns. But that evening, probably 10 years ago, I was not very interested in the arts or engineering, but I was more interested in Brachetto. It's a good Italian wine, very sparkly. So what happens is that Padova is a town with 100,000 students, and at night they gather in front of this Palazzo della Ragione in the piazza, and they drink a glass of wine before going to dinner. So what happened to me 10 years ago is that a colleague of mine, he said, look, there is a fellowship from the Italian government to go and work in the United States with the top scientists that do proteomic and biomarker discovery. And I couldn't believe. Then I start to dream. I mean, I can go for that. I can go to the United States. And then going home, I was thinking I will have to learn how to speak English and all these things. But it turned out that I got the fellowship, and now I came to the United States. And coming in the plane, I was thinking, well, now I'm going to join this group of famous proteomic researchers, and they are going to have the answer. So I have 12 months. I'm going to help them to find these cool biomarkers. I'm going to bring them back to Italy. I'm going to help so many patients with this blood test. Well, I came to the United States. I met the top-tier proteomic researchers, and what I found is that the field was not done yet. The technologies, they were extremely sophisticated, but still not able to deliver the promise. So, for example, in the last 10 years, they've been published 150,000 papers on biomarkers, promising thousands and thousands of biomarkers, very few useful in the clinic. And that was my first lesson when I came in the United States. If you do research, and if you do real research, you find yourself living on the edge, always facing some unresolved issues. When you get to the point that the issues are resolved and the roadblocks are overcome, then you move to something else. You don't do real research if all the area and all the work has been already done. So why the biomarker discovery field failed to deliver the promise? Well, because we are looking at very complicated biofluids. For example, if we look at the blood, the proteomics part of the blood is extremely complex, so very close to saturation, and most of this proteomic content is constituted by non-relevant proteins, like albumin and other protein that they are not related to any kind of disease. They're just there and they serve physiological function, but they don't tell us anything relevant to disease. And so all this overwhelming excess of proteins that don't come from the disease makes our quest for real biomarkers extremely challenging. And researchers came up with very sophisticated technology, and the main one is mass spectrometry, but is still not good enough. And we can see this problem like a metal detector, like a gold metal detector, and we are working here on the surface. And what this metal detector can tell us is all the biomarkers that are in the green box, and so the most abundant one. But unfortunately, the biomarkers that come from the cancer, at the early disease, the early stage, they are down here, so way below the range of the metal detector. So practically, we are looking for something that is completely out of range and invisible to our technology. That's why we kept looking and looking, but the tool we had to perform this search was not adequate enough, and that's why the field failed to deliver the promise. We were not able to bring to the clinic some biomarkers to really help patients, and that's why I'm still here. I didn't go back to Italy after 12 months, because there's still a lot of room for research. So how much do we miss? So some mathematical models have been done, and they tell us that if we want to look for traces in the blood of biomarkers that come from a small lesion, that would be we would need to improve our technologies 100,000-fold. So it's a big jump to make, and this is what we have to do. So what did we come up with at George Mason University? Oh, why is that? So blood-borne biomarkers are exist in very low concentration, again, because they come from a very small lesion, so they are very diluted. So let's say they come from a 1 centimeter lesion, and then they are diluted in 5 liters of blood throughout the body. That brings them the concentration down and are obscured by high abundance protein that are not related to disease. What is also extremely challenging is that they are rapidly degraded by proteases. That means that in the moment you take the blood out of the patients, there are enzymes that cut and chop these proteins very finely. And so they are ruined. And for us, the biomarker scientists that want to look for them, they are not available anymore. Plus, the known biomarkers lack adequate specificity. So in other words, we are not able to determine with the good specificity what kind of a disease is going on. So the solution we came up with at George Mason University is a smart nanotechnology. In particular, is a nanoparticle that performs different steps in a different function in one step. The first one is molecular size sieving. So it allows, and here I have a model that I can show. So let's think that this is the nanoparticle, of course, many, many times bigger. So what we have a bait or a hook that is engineered inside, and then the nanoparticle has a pore, like a hole, that is small enough to exclude everything that is bigger, but if we have a smaller protein that is able to penetrate, then interacts tightly with the bait, and so it's captured and protected. So this is the simple mechanism by which this technology works. So we mix these nanotraps in the body fluid, and then we let them go around and basically fish out the protein. And then we separate this nanoparticle from the biofluid. And here we have all the proteomic biomarker content that is going to allow us to detect the disease early. So we have this capability of doing size sieving and affinity capture. And then by virtue of this capturing the biomarkers, we have a concentration of the analytes. And when we were working on this technology, we were surprised to find that when the protein is inside, so interacts with the bait, is protected from degradation. So we don't have this problem anymore of the protein is chopped up by the enzyme, and so we don't see it. But now we are able to basically freeze and protect the protein in the moment we capture it with a nanoparticle. So chemically, these nanoparticles are a hydrogel, and they are polymeric hydrogel. They have a structure that has a core and a shell. And what chemically makes is the most important function and makes all this process possible is the chemical bait that we put inside. So this is how the particle look like. The bottom panel is a very far away view of the nanoparticles, so they are like spheres. And then up here we have a closer look, and up here is like a zoom in. So they are basically spheres. Most of the volume is constituted by water. So 90% of their volume is actually water. And that helps by helps the protein, the biomarker, to go inside, because we don't have any boundary, any diffusion boundary. So this is the structure. We have a core that has the bait or a hook that interacts tightly with the protein, and a shell. And the shell helps to sieve in the most effective way the protein. So how does the concentration concept work? Let's say we have a high volume of blood, and most of the proteins in the blood is constituted by non-relevant proteins. And then we have the few biomarkers. We add the particle to the biofluid, and the biomarker is captured. Then we isolate the particle from the biofluid, and we extract the biomarker in a smaller volume. So now our concentration factor is given by the volumetric ratio between the whole initial volume and the final smaller volume of a partially purified population of biomarkers. So in this case, it's 100-fold amplification. If we go from 5 mL to 50 microliters. Of course, the bigger volume we have to analyze, the bigger bigger concentration factor we can attain. So what do we use for the bait? The bait, the hook that we use to trap the protein, is really the heart and core of this technology. And originally, we started the first idea we had was to use a charge. So we would make this particle, let's say, negatively charged, and so we would capture positively charged proteins. And the opposite, we would have a positively charged particle, and we would capture negatively charged protein. That was good, but not good enough, and we knew we were losing, missing a lot of protein. So the next step was to figure out a good bait that was able to interact with the proteins and hold on to them, and allow us to have a better sensitivity. So we thought over it, and we figured out that what does bind to proteins? For example, dyes that we use to stain our fabric, or dyes that are used in allergy testing, or food dyes, and dyes that are used in immunohistochemistry. So we start to screen all these small molecules and see which one would interact with proteins and have a better performance. And that's why we came up with this colorful nanoparticles. And the color is not only for us to recognize the different kind of particles, but it's what actually gives the particle the ability to capture and hold on to the protein. So these are dyes that bind very quickly. And this is extremely good for us, because we saw that in few minutes, really few seconds, they bind to the target analyte, the target protein, and then they hold on to the protein for the longest time. And this is how the principle based on which we screen these dyes. We wanted to have extremely high, very quick on rate, an extremely slow off rate if we consider the chemical reaction of the equilibrium between the dye and the protein. So what is the benefit of using this nanoparticle for our biomarker analysis? Well, going back to the gold detector, here, it's two grays, it's not very clear, but if we look at our gold detector technology, we see that the range we can get to without a nanoparticle is down here. So if we go back to the concentration of proteins in the blood, we are able to see in micrograms per milliliter in our quest for biomarkers. As we saw before, this is completely not adequate to have a good biomarker, a good test for an early stage disease. Now, if we look, if we use the nanoparticle, we can increase our detection range, so our metal detector can go down here. And that, depending on the volume, we were able to attain 1,000-fold increase of this detection limit. So in this way, the technology is enabling, because it makes possible to detect some protein that they were otherwise invisible to the current technologies. This is an example on how we can use them. We can put a nanoparticle directly into the blood container tubes. Here we go. So this would be the nanoparticle. And then we add the blood directly into the blood container tube, and we have an example of purified protein and greatly enhanced low molecular weight proteins. So here we have an example of extreme concentration and size sieving. So here I have, I'm going to present three examples of application of this technology to three different diseases, just to give an idea on how can these particles benefit patients and go to the clinic. So the first project I would like to discuss with you today is the lung cancer project. So an example, this is an example, probably one of the most unusual examples we can think of patients that have lung cancer. So this case was of a female, age 30, and she was non-smoker. She's non-smoker and healthy, exercises regularly, and she started to have very strong pain in the lungs. So she went to the doctor, and the doctor did an X-ray, and he said, "Oh, you probably hurt yourself when you were exercising because you exercised too much," and he sent her home. But the pains didn't go back, and so she went to the ER 6 months later. They did a CT, and what they found was a stage 4 lung cancer. So that is an extremely serious disease and with extremely poor prognosis. So her choices at the time were just doing chemo, and she was healthy otherwise. So she responded well to the therapy, initially to chemotherapy, and the tumor regressed, and she had only a hollow cyst, so basically just some tissue that encapsulated the tumor. But then the chemotherapy stopped working, and she had to use different kind of drugs, what they're called targeted therapy, so smart molecules that bind to specific receptor and make the tumor regress. So at this point, she's responding well to this therapy. What she says is that she is not be able to be cured ever again, because at best she can be in this, she can be able to control the tumor but never eradicate it. So when they ask her what is the lesson you learned from this, she said, "The lesson I learned is that if we were able to do early detection, it would be the best thing. We will be able to eradicate the problem and be able to have a good long-term recovery." So lung cancer is, they say it's the first killer. Here are the estimate for the new cases in the United States, more than 200,000 in 2014, of which that's and that's 160,000. And the overall 5-year survival rate of lung cancer patients is extremely low, like 15%. Mostly because it's usually diagnosed very late. So for this type of cancer, what we really lack is a way to detect it early. So the lungs, they are used to respiratory exchange by the human body. And there is rising evidence that the origin of cancer from in smokers and non-smoker is extremely different. And what it looks like is that the cancer in tobacco smokers can likely rise in both in the central compartment of the lung, so in the bronchi, and also in the peripheral compartment of the lungs, whereas the non-smokers, it seems to arise only in the peripheral. So we have this hypothesis, but we still have a lot of understanding to gain on how this disease develops, especially in the non-smokers. So our example of the case report, she was diagnosed with lung cancer with the computed tomography, which is the usual the technology that is adopted by doctor to do screening and diagnosis of lung cancer. This is a very powerful technology and very sensitive. What is the problem? The problem, usually you have an imaging of your lung, and if they see something that is abnormal, they go ahead and do a biopsy. So they take a piece of your lungs. In this case, most of the time, the biopsy comes back negative, which is good for the patient, but is a problem for a screening test, because you really don't want to expose the patient to this unnecessary procedure that is very invasive. So the best screening tool we have at this point for lung cancer is this kind of imaging that is affected by a high false positive rate and a high overdiagnosis. So having a good blood test that can identify signs of lung cancer in the early stage can be an excellent complement to the current screening technology, because it can improve the specificity. In other words, if a person comes out to the doctor and has an abnormal imaging, then we can go ahead and do a blood test. If the blood test turns out normal, we don't need to have this invasive procedure that at the end is going to be useless. So the project we carry on at George Mason was focused, it did a step further. It was focused on identifying biomarkers that predict the risk of developing lung cancer. So we try to be a little bit, to play a little bit in anticipation here. We want to be able to detect the cancer before it develops. So risk of future risk of carcinogenic. These would be markers that are different. They can be different in smokers versus non-smokers, because as we saw, this biology of the tumor, it's emerging to be different in smokers and non-smokers. And if the old concept of the biomarkers was having a molecule that was detected in patients that already had the tumor, now we want to have a biomarker that comes from the pre-malignant phase. So of course, being able to do that would need to have access to patient samples that were collected before the cancer took place. And so we did. In collaboration with the Harvard Medical School, we had access to blood samples that were obtained from initially healthy men that eventually developed lung cancer up to 25 years prior to lung cancer diagnosis. So our biomarkers were proteins that were different in men that eventually developed biomarkers with respect to men that were healthy and did not develop lung cancer. So it was these samples come from a huge clinical study, the physician health study, and this was a clinical trial that was carried on for a different purpose. So the main purpose of the study was to understand if there was an improvement by using aspirin and certain vitamins on the incidence of cardiovascular disease. And it turned out that, yes, aspirin lowers the incidence of cardiovascular disease. To do that, scientists follow up to 30,000 men, almost 40,000 men over 30 years. They decided to follow physicians because they thought it was easier to work with physicians. And so they sent questionnaire out of all these physicians. And they asked the physician to draw some blood and send it to the central clinical trial. So all the participants were men and Caucasian because that was the population that was prevalent in the physician category at the time, starting from the 1980s. For our purposes, we see that 39% were former smokers, 11% were current smokers, and 50% non-smokers. So out of these 40,000 men, like 300 developed lung cancer during the period of the clinical trial. So it's these 300 men that we use to perform our study. Initially, we used 40 adenocarcinoma cases and 40 match controls. So for us to discover biomarkers that are really relevant to one disease, we have to be able to cancel all the non-relevant variables. And what is that? Age. We don't want to have one group, like the disease group, that they are all old and all the controls are all young, because then the age might play a role. So we match the case control for age. So for every, cancer patient that is 40, we are going to have a control patient that is 40 as well. And then we match for length of follow-up to diagnosis. So in other words, the patient was diagnosed 6 months later, and so was the case. Smoking status and enrollment. So the categories we have are three: never smoker, former smoker, and current smoker. And for current smokers, the number of cigarettes smoked in the day, because this is also a very important variable in the development of lung cancer. So we used the blood was sent to us by Harvard, and then we processed it with the nanoparticles, and we did our mass spectrometry analysis, and here we always have the graph that tells us that we can actually see something that otherwise was invisible to the technology. So what we found, we were able to identify small panels of proteins that can actually discriminate with a good confidence people that were going to develop lung cancer with people that were not going to develop lung cancer. So here we have a panel of 10 proteins, 9 proteins, 8 proteins that are extremely different between the two categories. So these are our candidates. These are proteins, again, that we find in the peripheral blood, but they have lung origin. So these are proteins that are shed from the lung to the blood, and we found different between the two categories. So they can tell us a risk of developing lung cancer. And what is also very important in studying these proteins is that we can have some clue on the molecular mechanism that underlies the development of lung cancer. So we can use them to devise a better therapy. We can target some of these proteins to perform maybe chemo prevention. So in other words, if I present this protein in my blood now, I can maybe target it before the lung cancer develops. So I use it, let's say, like a vaccine. The lung cancer will never develop because I block it beforehand. So example of these categories are, for example, for autophagy or inhibition of cell growth or mitochondrial metabolism. And what it was interesting emerged very clearly from the data is that the functional categories of these proteins were extremely different between the non-smokers and the former smokers and never smokers. And I was invited to present this data at the American Association of Cancer Research meeting last year. And so at this point of the presentation, somebody from the audience stand up and he said, oh, yes, that's good, very good research, but I think, let me tell you this. This was a study performed on people that were smoking 20 years ago. Now the tobacco industry makes cigarettes that are healthy, because we change all the composition of the cigarettes. And so this study might be good, but it's not up to date anymore. And so it was interesting, her observation. Of course, she was working for the tobacco industry. And the observation that we made to her is that what you smoked 20 years ago is still with you. I mean, the smokers that were smoking the bad cigarettes, not the good one, they still bear the consequences. Or put it in another way, there is a huge overlap of the functional categories of the proteins in the former smoker and in the current smokers. So there was a first validation. And then we had other 80 samples of new people. And we used the same panel of biomarker. And we saw that the discrimination power, so we were able to use the same markers to predict who was going to have cancer and who was not, with a very good accuracy. So this is the, to conclude this part of the project, we were able to identify from plasma of patients at risk of developing lung cancer, this panel of biomarkers that gave us, can give us good insights on the biology of the disease. And we can possibly use to devise some kind of pharmacological therapy that can stop the cancer even before it develops, so the cancer in the pre-metastatic phase. And we know that for a biomarker to go into the clinic, there is a huge journey. And so this is just the very first tiny step that is performed on a few hundred patients. And then we would need to go on several thousand to make sure that all the variability is taken into account. But this is just the first step. So that would be for the lung cancer. We also applied this technology to a similar problem, not a discovery problem, but a diagnostic problem, like being able to diagnose a disease in the early stage. And the disease that we are working on and is actually taking a lot of our time and a lot of our passion is a disease that can present like this in children especially. And being a parent, I know that if my daughter would come home with a facial paralysis like that, I would be terrified because it can be like anything ranging from, probably the most likely cause would be a stroke, and I don't want my 10 years old to have a stroke. And, but in this particular case of paralysis, it turned out that it was not a stroke, luckily, and the doctor saw it right and performed a blood test, and he figured out that it was instead a Bell palsy from Lyme disease. And good for the kid. She was given some antibiotic, and in less than 30 days, she was fine. She resolved the issue completely. But there are not all the cases with this disease that resolve with the happy ending. And here, it was another case of a kid that was bitten by a tick and went to the doctor. And the doctor said, if you don't see something like that, like a bullseye rash where the tick bit you, then you don't need to worry. And mother and daughter went home, and nothing came out in the skin of the daughter. So they didn't treat. The daughter was healthy, so she went through college, but the last year of college, she started to have the most horrible symptoms, like she was extremely fatigued and she couldn't concentrate, she felt foggy, and then she started to have problems in the joints, insomnia, depression, and eventually she became completely non-functional. Well, she tested for Lyme disease, and it turned out that she did have the infection, and just in her body didn't develop the rash that is typical for the Lyme disease, but the infection has been growing in her body, and at that time she started an extremely harsh course of antibiotics, extremely expensive, and it was much harder to cure. So our interest in Lyme disease started with Temple. Oops. Temple was a high school kid that came to do research in our lab one summer in 2009. And a lot of her family, including her dog, her mom, her sister, had Lyme disease. And so she said, oh, I kind of like your technology, but I would like to use it for Lyme disease. And so she did. She came to the lab and she did her own experiment and she published her paper and she was inventor on a patent. And that's how the interest of Lyme disease started. So Lyme disease is a bacterial infection that is transmitted by a tick. And so it's a vector-borne disease. It has an early stage that is mild, but if it's not cured, can give serious problems like complication of joint inflammation, cognitive defects, problems with the heart and memory loss. It's a very controversial field. What is certain about it is that the diagnosis of Lyme disease is extremely difficult. And is currently done with an antibody-based assay, so a serology assay, and together with symptoms. So the symptom would be the bullseye ash, but that doesn't happen in everybody. So overall, the specificity and sensitivity of the test is not very high. With the indirect test, so testing for the antibody, so the reaction that the body has to the bacteria, can have some problems. First of all, the body needs some time to develop these antibodies, so to go through seroconversion. And if we do this antibody-based test in the first weeks, we don't see any response. That doesn't mean that we don't have the infection. It only means that our body didn't have the time to develop the antibodies yet. And then if we are so lucky to have cured the infection, we are still going to have what we say immunological memory. So we are going still to have the antibodies circulating in our blood, but we are not sick anymore. So these are the problems that are inherent to the antibody test. But working a little bit of Lyme disease, we figure out that it is more than that. There is also a big discrepancy and a path, a divergent path between the public and the mainstream science. And an example of this is this episode that happened to Alan Stier. Alan Stier was the scientist, he's a rheumatologist at Yale. He was the guy who discovered Lyme disease. So in the late 70s and 80s, in the Lyme city of Connecticut, there was a lot of young juvenile arthritis that was very unusual. And so Dr. Stier starting to look into that. What was the cause of this juvenile arthritis that otherwise is very rare, and it was a high concentration in this Lyme city. And so he had the idea that we must have an infectious agent, and then they look into that, and they figure out it was a spirochete, the Borrelia burgdorferi spirochete. So he spent basically all his life working on Lyme disease. A few years ago, like in 2013, somebody from the audience like this stood up and he said, your papers, you killed my sister, you have your blood dirty with your hands dirty with her blood. And this is, having experienced the contact with the activists and the patients of Lyme disease, this is possible. There is a big, they are very animated. And why was that? Because Stier, after having discovered Lyme disease, he went ahead and published papers in which he said that he's completely overdiagnosed and is a name that Lyme patients give to very different kind of pathologies, such as chronic fatigue, myalgia, and Dr. Stier and all the mainstream scientists, they think is inappropriate to cure with strong antibiotic person that they don't have the disease. On the other hand, the patients, they think that they have the disease and they want a strong course of antibiotic. And the fact is made very complicated because we don't have a real diagnostic test. So we don't have any scientific evidence to tell do we have the infection or we don't have the infection. We just have very animate advocate from one side or the other. Since the mainstream science doesn't think this infection exists, the insurance company, they will not pay for the antibiotics, and they can be extremely expensive, over $5,000 a month. So it starts to be also an economic problem. But this guy went ahead and even did a movie speaking about his sister problem and how bad the scientists are and they kill her. And he even went ahead and said that the US government developed Lyme for a biowarfare. So there is a big animation. We also met some doctors that by willing to help these patients because they see that giving them a strong course of antibiotics, they were getting better, that they lost their medical license because there are regulations that are against the use of the antibiotic, and so they were highly sanctioned by certain states. So what happens is that these doctors that are called Lyme literate, they form their own scientific society and they carry on their own meetings that are parallel and in contraposition with the Infectious Disease Society of America. So in all this uncertainty and all this animation, what we wanted to do is having a true test. What is the truth? How can we really say if somebody has Lyme disease or not? So we saw that the serology testing, so the testing that looks for the antibody, has serious problems because it has what we say a false negative in early stage because the body didn't have time to develop antibodies. And we have persistence of antibody titer after successful treatment. In other words, if I had Lyme disease and I'm successfully cured, I still have the antibodies. The overall success in diagnosing Lyme disease is like 60%, 70. So it means like one third of the people that goes to look for a diagnosis is misdiagnosed. So what we propose to do, thanks, like by using nanoparticles, is doing an antigen test. Like we look for a piece of bacteria in the urine of patients. The hypothesis being that why would we have a piece of bacteria in our urine if we don't have an active infection? So that's what we're looking for. A test that can do an early stage disease because the bacteria is there even from the very beginning. And a disease that maybe comes after a therapy, so it's recurrent or persist in the face of therapy. We chose urine because it's a very easy to collect biofluid and doesn't pose any kind of stress on the patient. The protein we are looking for is called outer surface protein A, and it's a protein that exists in the surface of the bacteria. And it's been shown to exist in the bacteria in the inflammatory environment in the host, so it's a good marker for an active infection. What do we do? We collect the urine, which is yellow. Then we add the particles that are blue, so everything turns green, and then we isolate the particles, and we analyze this proteomic content of the particles, in this case with Western blot. So Temple's work back in 2010 demonstrated that we can reach a good sensitivity, good enough to try and work on patients. And so we started the clinical trial in which we collect urine from different patients, all comers, so maybe patients that are just bitten by a tick or patients that think they have Lyme because they've been suffering horrible symptoms for the longest time. We collect blood and urine. Blood is sent to the lab and it's performed the usual test, like the serology test by LabCorp or Quest. And the urine is sent to George Mason and we do the analysis in our CAP-CLIA certified lab. We have patients that are true positive, patients that are true negative, and patients that are in this gray area in which we don't know. They have serology, maybe positive, maybe negative. They have very harsh symptoms, but there is no certainty if they really have Lyme disease or not. And so what we plan on doing is tuning our test on the true positive and true negative and hopefully use this test to really figure out if the uncertain gray area of patients truly have Lyme disease or not. So going a little bit on technicality, to have a good test, we have to have very good reagents. So we screen our antibody to be sure that we're specific, and we want to be sure that the negative turn out negative. And in urine analysis, the true negatives are a very big problem. In the past test, they always turn out positive, and so we don't want to have false positive for that. So one of the first patients we saw, and they gave us a little bit of excitement and hope, is that without the nanoparticles, we couldn't see anything. With the nanoparticles, a band appears. So if we have a band in this membrane, it means we have a protein. So it means that by using the nanoparticle, we can actually see bacteria proteins, so pieces of the bacteria, in the urine of patients that have Lyme disease. So this is the proof that we needed at least to go forward. Then we go, unfortunately, we only have 8 true positive patients so far, but we see the band, so the bacteria protein is in the urine of all the 8 positive patients. And we have, for the few patients we followed before and after therapy, we could see that the band actually disappears. Is in the urine when the patient is sick, the patient is treated with antibiotic, cured, the bands goes away. So this is the kind of test that we want to have that can tell us if the patient is sick or not. So we are able, this is an example of data on the 150, probably now 200 patients that we collected. So the true negatives turn out to be true negative with our test, which is very important. Person that have strong symptoms and positive serology, they are also positive with our test. What is interesting is that person that have negative serology but still have symptoms, they are positive to our test. So it looks like the presence of the proteins in the urine correlates more on the symptom with the symptoms than with the serology. So this sensitivity we're able to reach is 1 picogram per milliliter, and we were able to detect bands in patients that were sick, but then after treatment, the band disappeared. So our hypothesis still holds that if we see a bacterial protein in the urine, very likely the patient is going to be sick. And so we have the antigen only in presence of an active infection. So our milestones at this point are very soon complete the clinical trial and have a commercial testing that is launched by summer of 2014. And then on the research side, we would like to extend the panel of biomarkers. So now we just want to look at one protein, but we want to look at more proteins of the Borrelia burgdorferi antigen to increase the specificity. And then what is very important, usually when people are bitten by a tick, they don't get infected only with Lyme disease, but there are a whole family of infections that come with it. And so it makes sense that somebody has a tick be tested with all the, what they're called the Borrelia complex diseases, like babesiosis and bartonellosis. And also measure host immune response factors that can be indicative of an active disease. So this is the last case that we're going to discuss today. And it started with an email that I received from a young scientist from Peru. And she said, oh, because this technology received at a certain point a lot of media attention. So she said, oh, I read in the newspaper of these nanoparticles, I would like to work on Chagas disease. And I said, Chagas disease, what is this? And then I went to see in the World Health Organization website, and it says, wow, affects 7 million people and kills up to 12,500 people each year. Must be something bad. So it is a disease that is spread in the Latin America mainly, but with the immigration, it's really going around the world. It's a tick-borne disease too, like a vector-borne disease. And so when the person are bitten by this bug, then they are infected by the disease. So an example would be Bertha was bitten by this bug, like the vinchucas, when she was a kid, and then she was healthy until she was in her 40s. In the meantime, she had kids, and then her husband left her, so she had to provide for all the family. When she was 44, she couldn't function anymore. She started to have horrible problems like extreme fatigue, swollen throat, spit blood. This disease, if untreated, it causes your esophagus to swell so much that you cannot swallow anymore. So they have to feed you with the tube. Eventually she got a stroke, and then the protozoa went into the heart, and she needed a pacemaker. With the pacemaker, she was fine. But this is a usual course of the disease if it's not treated early on after the person has been bitten. So also in the United States it started, and there is another case of a person like Maria that was denied, she couldn't donate blood with the Red Cross because she tested positive with Chagas disease. And she had no idea what it was, and the only thing they told her is that it could be fatal. But then she asked the doctor, what is this? How can it be fatal? And they said, and all the doctors she talked to, they said, we don't know. And so she always had this impending shadow of this fatal disease that she had, and nobody knew what to do. But now the awareness is increasing because it's, again, moving to the United States. And it looks like in California, like also high school kids, they've been infected directly from the bug. So the bug is migrating to the States too. And another way of transmission is congenital transmission. And that happened in Virginia for the first time in the United States. So if a woman is pregnant and is infected with the disease, can pass the disease to the fetus and the baby. So it's definitely spreading very quickly, and it's one of the neglected diseases, but hopefully this will change soon. That is the bug that transmits the disease, and they usually leave the bugs in mud housing, and another way of transmitting the disease can be through exchange of blood or body fluids, and again, congenitally. This is another disease, also because it's a neglected disease, that doesn't have very good diagnostic. So this picture here is one interesting way of diagnosing the disease, which is called xenodiagnosis. And so what they do, they put in this device some uninfected bugs, and they let the bugs suck your blood, and then they analyze the bug. So if the bug is infected, then they think you're infected. So we want to do better than that. And no, but the main diagnostic way is like doing a smear of your blood, and if in the smear they see the protozoa, the trypanosoma cruzi, then they declare that you're infected. Also, the treatment of Chagas is a little bit problematic because there are only two. The best thing is like kill all the bugs, which they did. Like in Bolivia and Peru, they did an excellent job in killing most of the bugs. But still, the congenital infection is a problem because in certain areas, the disease is endemic. We have only two medicines that were developed almost 40 years ago that are available to treat the disease, and they have very harsh side effects. And plus, they are effective only in the early stage. When the patient progresses to the late stage, it's not possible to do anything. You just try to fix all the problems like the esophagus or the heart, but there is no way to really cure that. They cannot be used in pregnant women, so there is no way to avoid that. But you can use the fetus, though. I mean, you can use it in the newborn. So the congenital transmission at this point is 1/4 of new Chagas infection. And using even molecular technology, we have low sensitivity. But what is most important in these low-income settings, like in Latin America, is that it's very hard to convince the mothers to bring back the baby to the hospital after like 6 months or 2 months for a serological testing. And so the need there is just to have a test that works right there. Immediately, one-time test without follow-up later in infancy. So with our, so eventually after this email that Jahaira, the young scientist from Peru, wrote me, I said, of course, I would be happy to work on Chagas, and she came, and we got to meet her and all her fantastic group that works in collaboration also with Johns Hopkins University, and they have clinical trials to help, really help the community in Peru and Bolivia. With their diagnostic tool, they help also spreading the treatment and also seriously ill patient with HIV co-infection. So yeah, Jahaira, she came to George Mason with 80 urine samples in newborns from endemic areas. So these have a high likelihood of being infected. Let's say that the percentage of infected mothers is 70%, and then we have a 30% chance of the mother to pass the infection to the baby, then we have a high likelihood of having an infected child. If we treat the child early, he's going to be fine. But if we wait, the disease progresses, we don't have any way to stop it. So we use the nanoparticles, and again, we mix the nanoparticles with this urine, tiny little bit of urine collected from the newborn, and with only one sample, so one collection of urine at 1 month, we have a very high sensitivity and very high specificity that does almost as well as the serology at 12 months. So this was a first step, and then of course we aim at developing even a point of care test that can be easy to use in this setting. So these were just three examples of a project that we are performing with the nanoparticles, but we can use this technology with a lot of other biofluids, such as saliva, cerebrospinal fluids, sweat, vitreous, ocular vitreous, and they've been successfully used even to trap whole viruses or viral proteins. And so many, many projects are going on and to come in the future. To try and help the patients a little bit in a more concrete way, a company called Sirius Nanoscience was spun off, and then now they've received a lot of funding to develop this technology, which is available for research sale right now, and they have collaboration with biotech companies like Shimatsu or Thermo, so they're doing very well. And well, this concludes my presentation, thanking, of course, all the wonderful colleagues that made all the work possible, thanking you for listening to me all this time, and of course, I will welcome the question if you have any.